Hallelujah. Good morning, everyone. You know, it's so important to know that when we come to church and we worship and we praise, it's so much more than just singing and just listening to the music. It's about participating in praising the Lord and worshiping, because that's when he comes down and his presence can be tangible and he can move and he can do whatever he wants to do. Hallelujah. So I encourage you all to press in this morning, to praise the Lord, to worship the Lord, because he is so worthy. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we love you so much. We pray that you come down and have your way. Do what you came to do here this morning as we worship you and we praise you. We love you so much. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Every word of worship, one accord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, when Jesus was on the cross, in the final moments, he said, "It is finished." And in those moments, there was a separation in the temple that separated us from the Spirit of God. But in that moment, when Jesus said, "It is finished," the temple curtain split in two. And you know what that means for us? That means that we have access to the Spirit of God at every moment of every day. We just have to press in and receive it. Hallelujah. Press in this morning. Press in. Press in until you get your breakthrough. Press in until you get what you need. Press in until the Lord drops a word in your spirit. Press in. Hallelujah. Oh, come, fresh wind come. Thank you, Jesus. So come like a flame of fire, a mighty rushing wind. Our praise will rend the heavens. Come fall afresh again.
The world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King. just wanna be with you.
Receive your healing.
My joy, fill this place.
Come on, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, lift up hands all over this place. Father, we just thank you for your mighty power, God. Lord, we're thankful that a changed life changes lives, God. Lord, we're thankful for every leader. We're thankful for every volunteer. We don't even really call them volunteers. Hallelujah. We call them serve team attendants, servers. We serve because we've been served. Amen. God served it up. He teed it up so that we can bring it down. Hallelujah. I want you to just put your hands to heaven right now. I don't know what you're in need of today, but I know that my God is awesome. My God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly more than we could ever think or imagine. I pray that as you lift up your hands, I pray that you would just begin to imagine everything that needs to be and everything that could be and everything that should be. I need you to imagine as if it's already been done. I said as if it's already been done. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible says that as a man thinketh, and I'd say, or a woman, come on, somebody, so is he. He uses that in a general context. So I want you to picture on the canvas of your mind the way things could be and the way things should be. You see, that's the birthplace of a vision. Hallelujah. I said, that's the birthplace of a vision. What gets you out of your seat is what moves your heart. There's some things I just can't sit down when I watch. There's some injustices that make me get out of my seat and do something about it. With every hand lifted in this room today, I pray right now that the Lord would impregnate you with a vision, that He'd put something deep inside that begins to stir up. I pray that He bothers you today. I pray that He bothers you so much that you say, Pastor, I've got to do something about this now. Right now. Father, I thank you for your mighty power and your mighty plan. Lord, I pray for the sons and daughters of God to be released right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Let the earth receive that which you call into your being, God, right now. Now I want you just to grab heaven and pull it right down into your spirit. Pull it right down and thank Him for it with your mouth. Say, thank you, Lord. I said, thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. Come on, thank Him. Thank Him with your mouth. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Now, the Bible says that we enter His gates with, but we can come into His courts with praise. Come on, we just thank Him with our mouths. Now, that's openly just begin to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise Him for the things that He's doing. Praise Him because He's worthy. Hallelujah. I've made a determination that no rock is going to cry for me. Hallelujah. Ain't no rock going to say hallelujah. I say it with my spirit. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for my family. Thank you for my kids. Thank you for this church. I thank you for these mighty men and women of God that you bring to a place called Crossroads. You know, we are in a new season, friend. Every hand down. Just look at me for a second. We are in a new season. We are in a new cycle. We're in the 8th year of our revival. I mean, we were on fire, but then we really caught fire. How many know what I'm talking about? Amen? I felt like this is the second church I've pastored. Right? I did the first one, you know what I mean? With a little bit of faith. But this second church that I pastor, I've been doing with some great faith. I said with some great faith. Listen, first service, the 9 a.m., it was just a testimony service. We had four powerful testimonies. I encourage you to go back and watch the broadcast. Let it build up your. See, listen, faith is a fire. It's the fire of God. John the Baptist said of Jesus, that I'm not even worthy to wear this man's shoes. I baptize you with water, but there's one coming after me who's greater. Say greater. He must become greater. I must become. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and? Holy Ghost and? Question, are they the same thing?
No.
I believe that fire is a supernatural substance called faith. Faith unlocks the supernatural. It's a master key in the kingdom. Amen? It unlocks a lot of doors. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As you return to your seats, I need you to prepare. You guys just hold tight right there. Your hearts for communion, number one. Well, one of the great things that we get to do at Crossroads Community Church is we get to dedicate babies. We don't baptize babies. We don't sprinkle them with water. Amen. We don't spit on them. We don't drizzle them. We don't drown them. Can someone say amen?
Amen?
We don't hold them under the water. We do that to adults. Amen. But babies are dedicated. We see in Scripture that they brought their child unto a man of God to be dedicated unto the Lord. And there's no greater joy in celebration than new life. Can someone say amen? We celebrate it naturally, and we celebrate it supernaturally. I said, this is a supernatural church. What kind of church is this? It's a supernatural one. This isn't an organization. This isn't the Rotary Club. This isn't the Kiwanis. This is the church of the risen Christ, and his name is Jesus Christ. Amen. You know what? I'm just getting pulled strongly over here. I feel, man, you've shifted something in this atmosphere today. Something you broke through. I feel like there's a, like, broke through. And as you stand to the Lord and as you put your hands, I need you to stand for a second, okay? Come on. I don't know what you're believing God for, but man, you're tapping into something and you're pulling on my spirit hard. Oh, the Lord told you that was happening? Well, good. That's called a confirmation. So someone praise the Lord for that. Amen. As you put your hands, oh my God, I'm getting overwhelmed with his presence. Whew. I have every hair. I don't even know. Just let that go, okay? Father, I pray that, Lord, that gift that's being stirred up inside of, I know it's the gift of faith. Lord, I pray that it begin to manifest the things that they pray for. Lord, I know that, Father, that your presence is more powerful than any enemy, any force, any darkness. We know that the light drives out the darkness, and that cloud of darkness has been lifted now over the things that you've been praying over. Whatever's been hindering that breakthrough is removed in Jesus' name. And right now, your breakthrough comes from heaven in Jesus' name. Lord, right now, I pray that it would get stronger and stronger in Jesus' name. Lord, I praise you and I thank you. Hallelujah. Lord, I'm thankful for the gift of faith. Lord, I'm thankful for your supernatural presence, Lord. Lord, right now, I pray that it increases, and I pray that the revelation that you've given her moves to manifestation now. It doesn't promote frustration, but it brings exhilaration in Jesus' name. Let it be done in Jesus' name. Woo! Come on, clap those hands, all you people. Hallelujah. It's with great honor. I'm going to ask that the Belair family just come and join me on this platform. Christine and Dana And Cooper, why don't you come and join me? And I'm going to ask that the family comes behind them. As they come forward, let the family come behind them now in Jesus' name. This is a wonderful family. How many know Mindy Bragg here? Mike Bragg, this is their daughter. Come on, clap those hands, all you people. This is her wonderful husband. I'm going to stand right here. Hallelujah. Come on, family. Oh, look at these guys, huh? Oh, my word. Where's Grandma, Grandpa? Oh, you guys are blessed, huh? Woo, look at these guys. Don't be. Oh, look, he's got a sheep. Oh, he's a. Oh, it's a llama that turned into a sheep. You were once a llama, now I call you. So let's gather behind them, you know. Let's get some of the taller ones in the back. Mike. He's got right here. What are you doing with that Yankees hat on? Okay. All right. Okay, this is a place of forgiveness. Okay, there you go. You come right up here. Now, you're all lopsided on one side, so, yeah, some of you come over here. Let's make the picture nice, okay? You're happy, huh? I'll tell you, can you two guys just come over on this side? How about that? There you go. Actually, you stay right there and you go over there. Perfect. Look at that. Oh, that's nice. The Blair family. Very nice. Very nice. You have a beautiful family, even though you're a Yankees fan, okay? No, that's okay. We like New York. We like beating New York. We don't know what's going to happen this year, but hey, why are we talking baseball? Let's talk baby dedication. Because we can't talk about golf. We know how that goes, okay? But there's no greater joy than to enter somebody into our fold. Look at this young, precious boy with striking blue eyes. Oh, blue eyes, you know. Paul Newman's, and he, exit one, enter the other one. You know what I mean? Son, you're going to have a blessed life. Okay? Lord have mercy. Now, I need you all to pray with me for a second because he eyeballed me like, don't touch me. Okay? But let's just pray that God would soften his heart right now. Okay? Because I've got a spotless track record and I'm not going to give it up in Jesus' name. Okay? Hey. Okay? They got little tricks. But with every hand raised right now, Father, we pray for this family. Lord, bless them. Come on, say, bless them, Lord. Bless them, Lord. And we thank you for it now. And we just know that, God, wherever your presence is, there's fullness of joy and pleasures at your right hand, Lord. Bless them now in Jesus' name. And as we take Cooper into our arms right now, we bless his holy name. And, Father, we dedicate this child to the work of God, the things of God. Lord, let him stand before men, kings, and queens, God, and let him be a bringer of light, God, that would come into this world, that would change many hearts for the kingdom. We pray all these things now. We dedicate them. Let them be dedicated and anointed now. In Jesus' name, we lift them up to you, and we dedicate his little life to the work of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let him be anointed all the days of his life. Oh, he is anointed and dedicated. Hallelujah. And he didn't cry in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Ladies and gentlemen, the Cooper family. I mean, the Blair family, sorry. Cooper Blair. Hey, you sit down, okay? We've got a professional photographer, not Mr. Awesome, taking pictures today, okay? Pastor, okay. Oh, okay. You guys are awesome. You are a blessed man, my friend. You are so blessed.
Amen. Oh.
God bless you. Come on, ladies and gentlemen. That's a 100% track record. No cry. No worry. No cry. No. With every hand raised in this house, as we prepare for communion, I pray right now that you get every heart ready to receive. I pray that as we participate in the body and as we participate in the blood of Jesus, I pray that that blood covers every sin. I pray that that body heals every person. Lord, we know that even though we think that we are staying in the same place, that we're always moving forward, moving up with Jesus. Hallelujah. Doesn't matter what people say. Doesn't matter what people think. It matters what he says, and it matters what he thinks. Hallelujah. And Lord, I pray that you'd prepare every heart to receive communion today in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said. Amen. Let's welcome Pastor Roberto and Pastor Jeffrey and Pastor Steve as they come.
Hallelujah. What a beautiful experience. God's into families, amen? Guess what? He instituted them. And if I could encourage you for a minute, you could do this with your families as well. Receiving communion isn't something that necessarily needs to be done just strictly when we come together as a church body, but as husband and wife, you can grab some juice and some bread and take a moment and honor God. Honor the Lord for his sacrifice. So I'd like to encourage you to do that this week. Grab some bread. Grab some good old-fashioned Welch's grape juice. Take a moment and thank the Lord for his body and his blood. Amen? Now, we know in 1 Corinthians 11, the Apostle Paul encouraged all of the believers to take a moment and reflect. To take a measure of some of the thoughts they may have been having or some of the feelings or emotions that may have gone through that don't line up with the word of God. So I want to encourage you, before we receive communion, let's partake together in seeking the Lord and having that moment of repentance. If there's anything that has set itself up in your life against the word of God, anything that has set itself up in your life against another brother or sister in Christ, I want to encourage you, release that over the next few moments.
Sweet presence of God. Simple words of repentance, I'm sorry. First Corinthians chapter 11 talks about the Lord's Supper when he sat down with his disciples. When God sent his son Jesus to die, Jesus died on that cross for us. Christ gave his body so that we can become the body of Christ. That holy transfer took place. And as the word says, do this in remembrance. What are we remembering today? That we are part of the body of Christ. Chapter 12 says the human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body. So it is with the body of Christ. We are that body, and today we hold the bread in our hand to remember what Christ did for us.
Praise God. Keep your eyes closed and just keep reflecting on this moment. This is something Jesus did not take lightly. This is your moment. Make it personal. Jesus came to die for each and every one of us on that cross. A man who lived a life did nothing wrong. But yet he was beaten and hung on that cross for us. All we have to do is come to believe. Book of Hebrews says this. You have come to Jesus, the one who mediates the new covenant between God and people, into the sprinkled blood, which speaks of forgiveness instead of crying out for vengeance like the blood of Abel. That's how powerful Jesus Christ's blood is. It speaks to God for us. Forgive them. Forgive them. All we got to do is come to believe.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. We remember what he did on the very night that he was betrayed. Our Lord and Savior, he took the bread and he lifted it up to heaven and he gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, take this, all of you, and eat. This is my body, which I freely give up for you. You may partake, family. And in the same way, he took the cup of his blood, and he said, this is my blood, the cup of the new covenant, the cup that erases every sin throughout history, the cup that empowers the believer to be his witness. And he lifted it up to heaven, and he gave thanks, and then he gave it to his disciples and said, drink, this is my blood of a new covenant established. Remember that, family. We have been established by the blood of Jesus. New, redeemed, restored, revealed to the world as saints. Every letter that Paul penned, he said, to the saints in Ephesus, to the saints in Galatia, to the saints in Rome, if anyone is in Christ, because of what Jesus did and that acceptance and that confession, we are new creations. You may partake. Can we give it up to these amazing men standing to my left and to my right? Proverbs 27:17 says, iron sharpens iron. And I am grateful to have many men and women of God alongside me here at Crossroads that sharpen me. Amen. We here in Massachusetts cheer for the Red Sox and the Yankees. Iron sharpens iron. Amen, Pastor. You know, it's a fantastic thing to be in the middle of connect groups and to think of everything that's going on here at Crossroads in spite of what the enemy is trying to do. We know what God's doing here at Crossroads. We're ready to launch an amazing kids ministry. The overhaul, if I could give it up for a minute to KMF Painting, to everybody that served, to everybody that's given of their time, talent, and treasure. See, here's the reality. When God established the family, a husband and a wife and children, he also entrusted the church to teach the children, to pour into them the very living word of God, to instruct them in the precepts of the scriptures. Pray for your families. Something that my brother in Christ and I talk about all the time. Our men's ministry leader here, Pastor Steve, he tells me all the time, Bert, if the man gets saved, the family gets saved. If the family gets saved, the community gets saved. If the community gets saved, the city flips around. Then the state, then the country. And the reality, if you look through history, America started falling apart the minute the family did. But we're here at Crossroads remembering the roots of Christianity. So as we receive an offering this morning, I want to encourage you. Don't forget, Proverbs chapter 11, verse 10 gives us great reminders of why we are to prosper. We believe in John 10:10 here at Crossroads. It's in the Bible. We believe in Jeremiah 29:11 here. It's in the Bible. Proverbs 11:10 is in the Bible. When the righteous prosper, the city rejoices. You just received the body and blood of It ain't you, it ain't me, it's Jesus. When the righteous prosper, the city rejoices. When the wicked perish, we celebrate. There are shouts of joy. I want to encourage you this morning. The purpose of your prosperity is to advance the kingdom of God, to be different. See, people have a problem with prosperity when it becomes greed. But when you're operating under the anointing and the will and the purposes and precepts of God, the entire city rejoices. I want to encourage you. Remember your purpose. You're a Christian. That's right, little Christ, that's me. Jesus had more hair than I did, but his spirit lives within me, and I'm a Christian. That's why I give, and that's why I serve. Now, if you're here for the first time and you've never seen anything like this, come on back. We get better and better. We believe that God continues to grow his people, to make a distinction in the earth. I want to encourage you. There's a connection card in the seat pocket in front of you. If you're here for the first time, grab it. We'll get you some information. If you're watching online for the first time, just drop the number one in the comments. And we have a ministry here called Growth Track that'll help you get to know what we believe and why. And it's all rooted in 66 books. It's all rooted in the Bible. I just gave you three verses in the last 5 minutes. Go look them up. And you can like me on Facebook and ask any questions you want. I'd love to have a Bible study with you. Amen? We believe in the Word of God here at Crossroads. So I want to encourage you, if you haven't been part of Growth Track, just drop GT right in that comment card. 2 seconds, two letters. You could do that online as well. Just drop the letters GT. As we receive the offering, let me pray for you. I want to encourage you to remember, not just on Sunday morning, remember what God's called you to do, to be his witness. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for giving up your body willingly, knowing what it would take. We thank you for loosing your blood and giving it up so that we could be washed clean, God. Lord, receive what is already yours. Receive this tithe and this offering. It is already yours. We just say thank you. And Father, help us be good stewards of the divine nature that you've given us, God. Let us be your witnesses in everything that we say and do. In Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Hallelujah. Two more things to remind you of. 6 o'clock tonight, we've got youth group. Amen. So I want to encourage you. If you got some young people that need to get touched, make sure you come. And also, as we just prayed, we're going to pray again and again. Each and every Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, Pastor has entrusted his pastoral staff to lead the body in prayer. So join us. Amen. God bless you, family.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. With everyone standing, just in transition, let's just lift our hands one more time to the Lord. Let's ask Him to prepare our heart to receive the Word of God, the seed of God. I pray that as the Word goes out, it does. I know it doesn't come back void, but I pray that the seed falls on good soil today. Let the soil be ready to receive the seed, the Word of God. Lord, I pray that You begin to stir up every heart right now. And Lord, I pray for manifestation of Your presence, Lord. I pray for increase, not only in their hearts and in their spirits, God, but increase in their lives and in their families. Lord, I pray for multiplication. Lord, I pray that Your power would be manifested in this place this morning. This is the church of the risen Savior, and His name is Jesus Christ. Unless the Lord builds the church, we know that the laborers labor in vain. And Lord, we know that this church, this building was dedicated to the work of God. Lord, protect the work, guard the work, guide the work. And Lord, I pray right now that every person receives all that they need and all that they ask in Jesus' name. And let every person say amen. Amen. And now give this clap offering for this wonderful worship team that has led us consistently in mighty, powerful worship. You guys are awesome. Just awesome. Come on. Somebody clap those hands. Hey. Okay. We got not much time. Go ahead and open up your Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I think that's the first time I've ever said you say don't worry about the time. That's powerful. With every hand lifted one more time. Father, help us with our time. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let me know when you're in 1 Timothy chapter 4. Titled this message, Guard the Fire. Guard the Fire. Last week, I preached to you about hearts on fire. That fire is the faith of God that gets inside of a person that ignites something different. It's called new life in Jesus Christ. Do I have anybody that's received new life in Jesus Christ in this room today? With that new life comes new things. A new joy. The things that used to make me happy don't make me happy anymore. And the things that I get happy on now, the drug that I get high on now, is called the Most High God. Amen. Let me just say this. If you ever use drugs or using drugs, you know, there's no high like the Most High. Okay? Listen, you want to get high? You can get as high as you want on the Holy Ghost. Okay? Let me tell you how high you can get. You can get so high that you'll pass out on the floor. You can get so high that you'll wake up in another part of a building. You can get so high that you can't even drive home. Okay? You can, someone says, I've been there. I've been there too. I was praying here and I woke up over there. Okay, that's high. That's really high. Because I've done drugs in my past and I've never had a blackout moment ever. Okay, okay, okay. But if you're praying over there and you wake up over there, something happened. Something happened. And the feeling I got when I came out over there, I was feeling really high, really good, all over my whole body, todo. Because there's no more powerful presence in this earth than the Spirit of the living God, the one who created this earth. Amen? And the person that created this earth lives inside of us. All of God's fullness dwells in bodily form. Do you understand that? The fullness of God dwells inside of us. Say this with me. Say, I lack nothing. Say, I lack nothing. I have everything. I lack nothing. And so the Apostle Paul is writing to Pastor Timothy, and he's given him some instructions in 1 Timothy. There was problems. Say problemo. There's problems in the church that Pastor Timothy was pastoring. And Paul's giving them instructions on how to deal with those problems. How many know that every pastor needs a pastor? If you are the highest authority in your life, you're not going very far. Okay? Every pastor needs a pastor. 1 and 2 Timothy is written by the Apostle Paul to Pastor Timothy to combat false doctrine, false teaching, and problems in the church with the sheep. And to tell Timothy that you need to get on fire, you need to stay on fire, and you need to guard the fire if you're going to stay as pastor of the church. Can someone say amen? Amen. The last place I ever want to be is in a dead church with dead people, with no anointing, with no presence. Hallelujah. When God makes you alive, you're alive. Amen. God's not dead. He's still alive. So we shouldn't act like dead people, like we've been baptized in lemon juice. I don't know why they play that song. It ain't for you, okay? You should be happy that other people are getting happy. Can I get a witness? You should be blessed that somebody else is getting blessed. We are blessed to be a blessing. You can't keep the blessing for yourself. This is my blessing, okay? Don't touch my blessing. This is mine, okay? Okay? God didn't bless you to keep it. God blessed you to be a blessing. Say, I'm blessed to be a blessing. You see, if God can get it through, he'll bring it to you. A lot of people lack because they don't give. See, it gets so quiet in the church. You bring up money or you bring up healing. Why is it that when you bring up money, prosperity, and healing in the church of Jesus Christ, God's people get tight? They get tight. I mean, they're squeezing themselves so tight. I don't even want to say it. They get so cheap that they choke the buffalo on the nickel. They're like, buffalo on the nickel. You're too young if you don't know what I'm talking about. How many remember the buffalo on the nickel? Okay, now I'm talking to some people here, okay? There's a buffalo on the nickel, okay? And some people were so cheap that they choked that coin so tight that that buffalo passed out because it had no oxygen. You know, they hold on to Abraham Lincoln so tight, $5. And they want to tip God like he's a waiter. With bad service. And listen, while I'm on tipping, okay, where's all my servers at? Where's people that work in restaurants or worked in a restaurant? Okay, God bless you, number one. Okay, don't be a cheap tipper. Okay, don't be cheap. You give God a bad name when you give like a $2 tip on a $200 bill. Okay, okay? Don't be cheap. Okay, that's a free one. So Paul's combating these problems, this false doctrine, these false teachers. It's not that he, okay. I want to get pulled. Let's not get pulled. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14. It says, do not neglect the spiritual gift you received through the prophecy spoken over you when the elders of the church laid their hands on you. Is this a church that lays hands on people? You bet your bottom dollar we are. You know why? Because that's the church of Jesus Christ, my friend. I said, that's the church of Jesus Christ. Well, they don't lay hands at our church. I'd be out of there so quick. Okay? If nobody was getting slain in the spirit, nobody was getting prayed over, and they weren't laying hands on anybody, if you weren't allowed to lift your hands, I'm out. I'm out. I was at a church where, like, I'm the only one. I look around, there's like 2,500 people. Me and my wife were the only ones lifting hands through no anointed worship. Just because I don't come to receive it, I come to bring it, friend. Okay? I bring it. Right? And we're up there just praising the Lord, singing the songs. I'm feeling absolutely nothing from the worship team. Okay? Nothing. Zero. How many know that we can feel the Holy Ghost? We can feel the Spirit of God. We can sense the Spirit. Yeah, she's receiving it right now. Like, we can sense it, we can see it, we can receive it, we know it, we can taste it. We understand the anointing. Why? Because we have the Spirit of God. Do I got anybody in this room that has the Spirit of the living God? You can sense the anointing when it gets near you. You kind of, okay. All right. That's something greater that we're carrying. I'm a carrier of His presence. Amen. When I step into a room, the atmosphere changes. I said the atmosphere changed. It's going to change. When you step into a scene now, I'm telling you right now, everything is going to change. Why? Because of what you're carrying. You pulled something down from heaven, my dear. I can feel it in my spirit. I'm attracted to His presence, okay? It's like a magnet. I can sense when God's coming down, I'm coming over. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? So here we've got, there's three things I want you to remember in this service today. Number one, say this with me. Say, what I have, what I give, and what I guard. What I have, what I give, and what I have. I mean, what I guard. Okay, what I have is a gift. I'm gifted. I don't say that like pridefully, I don't know how to even say that, like, you know, arrogantly. I say that humbly because God has gifted me with His presence. God has gifted me with His Spirit. God has gifted me with His anointing. God has gifted me with His prosperity. God has gifted me with His Holy Ghost and fire and power. I know what I have. I'm a carrier of this presence. And when I step into a room, it's not me that changes the atmosphere. It's Him that changes the atmosphere through me. Do I got anybody else like me in this room? Come on, anybody else a carrier of His presence? Anybody else want to stand for His glory, for His power, for His dominion, and for His anointing? Hey! Carrier. Anointed, I know what I have. I know who I am. I know who He is. And I know who my adversary is. You can never defeat an opponent you can't identify. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. Look around. Look what God's doing. He's on fire. Correct. Correct. And I'm going to stay on fire because I'm going to guard the fire. What I have is a supernatural, spiritual gift that God gives everyone. I just received it. I know that there's others that received it. I want you to put your hands up like this. I dare you to put your faith in God. I dare you to trust Him at His word. I dare you to put your hope, your life, your family on the altar of God. I dare you to trust Him at His word. Now, just pull it down. Pull down the special gift of God. It's called the fire. Fire. Fire warms people up. It warms the frozen people. Sometimes they de-thaw and you're like, oh my God. And other times you say, oh my God. It's time for people to stop playing church. They have no idea what the ecclesia is. The church isn't a building. We are the church, the collective body of Christ. Amen. God's going to do something great with you. I see it all over you. You are anointed for a great work. Amen. I don't care what anybody said about you. Okay. I don't care what those friends, you know what I mean, try to say. You right here. Put your hand, I dare you to put your hands on the Lord. Just put them up like this. Father, give her something special that everybody would know comes from you. Lord, bless her so much that people are like blown away by you. I pray this in Jesus' name. I thank you for her today. I'm thankful that she's on the front row. And Lord, I pray that she gets the VIP ticket today, the VIP experience, because she's a very important person. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You ever been here before? You probably sat back there before. A little different up here, huh? Yeah. Because the closer you get to the fires, the hotter you get. Amen? The hotter you get. Say what I have. You have a special spiritual supernatural gift from God. Paul's writing to Timothy, and he says, do not neglect the spiritual gift in verse 14 you received through the prophecy spoken over you when the elders of the church laid their hands on you. Give your complete attention to these matters. Throw yourself into your task so that everyone will see your progress. Keep a close watch on how you live and on your teaching. Stay true to what is right for the sake of your own salvation and the salvation of those that hear you or watch you. Other translation says, watch your life and doctrine closely. Watch your life and doctrine closely. There is a lot of, I would say, churches, fellowships, whatever you want to call it. To believe God and deny his power is to not believe God at all. There's a difference between believing in God and believing on God. You could build your life on God. I'm a living testimony. Everything I have came from God. My children are a gift from God. We weren't supposed to have kids. The guy sat around from the bushy eyebrow doctor. How many remember the story, right? Oh, I ain't gonna promise you anything. We're at a fertility specialist. My wife had PCOS, polycystic ovarian syndrome, cancer, polyps of her ovaries. Her fallopian tubes were blocked. No eggs coming out. No tengo aquí, okay? Not happening. But I had a vision in prayer, praying with the T-Challenge brothers. Didn't make sense then, but made a whole lot of sense when I'm sitting across the table from a bad report. And I've seen four kids, three girls and what I thought was a boy, but later I realized it was just Kiki with her hair cut short. She looked like a little boy at the time, you know? What are you going to do? I remember Kiki with the short hair. Yeah, okay. Because it was a little odd when I had the fourth girl. I'm like, yeah, I thought that was Laura. But I'm sitting across from the table, and I remember looking at the doctor. I said, I don't care what you're saying. I only know this. God showed me a picture of my kids. We'll do our job and do it well. You do your job, and God will do his job. We all have a job to do. I know what I have, and it's a vision that only comes from God. Whose report will you believe? And something supernatural took place in that moment. And she got pregnant, and we lost the baby. She got pregnant again. Hallelujah. We lost the baby. But she got pregnant again. And we've been trying to figure out how to shut that factory down ever since. Because we're good. But see, faith is a supernatural substance. It's a currency that God answers. Say this with me. Say, God answers faith. Say it one more time. Say, God answers faith. All those online, I want you to type that in the comment section. Say, God. No, you can say it too. Say, God. This is for the Holy Ghost now. God answers faith. Now clap those hands like you believe it. Come on. Faith. What I have, the spiritual gift that I have is the gift of faith. He's given me other gifts, but faith is the gift that unlocks a lot of the other gifts. Can someone say amen?
Amen.
Do not neglect the spiritual gift you received through the prophecy spoken over you, Timothy, when the elders of the church lay their hands. He's bringing them back to his encounter. He's bringing them back to his point of contact with faith. When you believed, you received. When we lay hands on you, there's two things you could do. Reject the Spirit of God. You could reject it, or you can accept it. You can reject it, or you can accept it. Say, I accept all that God has for me. What is the spiritual gift? That's the spiritual gift of faith. This whole thing is talking about faith. It's reminding Timothy of his faith. Paul's letter to Timothy in 1 and 2 Timothy and 2 Timothy was to build him up in his faith because Timothy was discouraged. Anybody get discouraged? Come on, be honest. Say, I get discouraged sometimes. I haven't been discouraged lately, but I've been discouraged before when God doesn't do what I want. Here, let me give you a news flash. I'm going to help you out right now. God doesn't do what you want to do all the time. God wants you to do what he wants you to do. Okay? He doesn't want you to use him. He wants you to follow him. Amen? He doesn't want you to use him. He wants to use you. It's different. It's backwards. Okay? And when you allow God to use you, you will see great and mighty things. You will soar like an eagle, not flap around like a chicken. You won't eat off the ground. You'll eat of the choice of the land. Can someone say amen? Can someone give a better amen? Can someone give their best amen in this house? Now we're talking, friends. Okay? It says, do not neglect your spiritual gift. See, the gift of faith is the key that unlocks all the spiritual gifts. Did you know that? You can't lay hold of the spiritual gifts without faith. You can't even receive the Holy Ghost without faith. Faith is a spiritual substance that God responds to. As you put your faith, hope, and trust in God, God begins to do great and mighty things, not only in you, but through you, for you, and all around you. Can someone clap those hands if they've been used by God? Come on. See, 1 Corinthians 12:4 says that there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of them all. It's the source of them all. The fire of God runs on the oil of God or the Spirit of God. You can't stay on fire without a source. What I have is a gift. What you have is a gift. It's a supernatural gift, Charlie. God has placed something inside of you. He's done something supernatural, not only in you, but in your wife, in your family. Even your kids will be blessed. Can someone say amen? God's going to use you and he's going to work through you. And the children of this church and the youth of this church shall be blessed because of the anointing that is on you, the anointing that is in you. Come on, hallelujah. See, if you set yourself on fire, people will come to watch you burn, baby. They'll come to watch you burn. See, the gift of faith is something that we receive when we come to Christ. We all receive a measure of faith, according to Romans 12, 3. God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, I'm thinking, if there's a measure, how big is that measure? And can I get another one? And another one? And another one? How many know we go from glory to glory, from faith to faith? Come on, hallelujah. Come on, what you believed God for yesterday, when you get it today, what are you going to believe for him tomorrow? Come on, you got to start today and get it tomorrow. Faith is now for something that's to come, right? what you are receiving today isn't faith. That's what you had faith for yesterday. Faith is a fire that can be built upon. Faith is a supernatural gift that ensures our victory. It's a supernatural currency or gift that ensures our victory. 1 John 5:4, for every child of God defeats the world, this evil world, and we achieve this victory, what? Through what? Our faith. Not through somebody else's faith, through our faith. Faith ensures your victory. God's greatest blessing is for you to believe his word. And his greatest upset is for you to deny it. Nothing troubles the heart of God more than somebody rejecting his word. He wants all to come to the saving knowledge that Jesus has learned. He wants everyone to operate in great faith. How many know that you can have faith, no faith, little faith, and great faith? On my tombstone, I want them to write, he was a man of faith. Because I know that'll please the Lord, because it's impossible to please him without it. I want to please God. And I want God to be blessed by what I do just as much as I'm blessed by what he does. Come on, this is a relationship that we're in. I said, this is a relationship that we are in. I want him to be blessed just as much as I'm blessed. And the more I feel like I bless him is the more that he blesses me. My whole life, everything in my house even, my cars, I've gotten everything I have before I had any money to buy them. I've stepped out and God showed up. Some people might think that's stupidity, but I find that to be a great blessing in my life. Amen. God gives me an instruction, I follow it, and God shows me his great and mighty power. God showed me the picture. I said, that's the house. It's the house. I showed my wife. She goes, that's too big. It's just me and you. Okay. Okay. Remember, vision, 4 kids. Right? House was sold. Off the market. I was getting ready to sign a P&O. Is that right? Purchase to offer, right? Purchase sale, P&S. Sorry. Okay, a P&S. And the real estate agent was on its way, but my mother, on Sunday morning after service, went by the house, took down the number of the real estate agent, called her. She goes, I'm sorry, but this house is sold. She goes, how sold? She goes, 99% sold. She goes, well, that's great because there's that 1% chance that this thing falls through, and when it does, I need you to call me right away. The real estate agent is on my way to the church for me to sign the P&S for a house that we probably would have lost our shirts on when the market crashed. And Mama calls me. She goes, I just got a call back from that real estate agent. I'm going to look at that house at 4 o'clock. That deal fell through. Can you meet me over there? I said, I got the real estate agent coming over. She goes, just call her and tell her, forget it. Okay. I call. I said, I'm sorry about that. She was so mad. And then we go over there. We're walking around the house. The more I got closer to the house, the minute I start walking through the house, I can just feel God stirring up inside of me the gift of faith. Hallelujah. They wanted like X amount of money. And we shot them a low ball price. And God opened up the door. And now we live in a house that's right around the corner from the church, the house that God showed me that was already sold. Can someone say amen? Can someone say a hallelujah? Can someone say glory to God? Can someone stand up on their feet and give God at least 30 seconds of praise for answering our faith? We go from victory to victory, from faith to faith. Can someone say amen? Amen. Let your amen be the loudest. Faith is what I have. It's what you have. Faith is a supernatural gift that ensures our victory. Now, that was just the start of faith. Faith is a fire that if you keep throwing logs on it, testimony after testimony after, you just keep throwing logs, you just keep believing God, you can build a great fire. How many throw a bunch of pallets together and lit that on fire? Oh, yeah. There's fires, and there's fires. But see, the gift of faith can be neglected. According to the Apostle Paul, an unattended fire will go out. There's a lot of pilots that are very low right now. There's a lot of fires that are barely burning in people's hearts. Fear-mongering, fear, plagues, plandemics, pandemics, conspiracies, racism. That's all a plot to destroy our country, to divide the people of God. This is the United States of America, not the divided states of America. Can someone say amen? Can someone give a better amen? Come on, this place was founded on unity, unity on the things of God. The Constitution protects the unity of us, the people of the United States of America. Come on, can someone say amen? There's some things that they put in place to guard us, to guide us, to help us, to protect us from tyranny. And people that come in and try to destroy us. And God has done the same thing. It's called the Bible. It's called the Word of God. The Word of God has been given by God as the Declaration of Independence for the believer to trust God and to be liberated from the bondage of sin. When I got saved, I got delivered, man. Oh, I got delivered. I got set free, man. I was changed. When I came out of the water, I came out as drug addict Brian, then I came out as Pastor Brian. I had no idea. Anybody else know what I'm talking about? I had no idea. Did you believe that you're going to be a Monet representative and have a whole team of people below you? No, I dare you to put your hands to the Lord right now. God, I pray that you continue to use that wonderful woman of God right there. I pray that your hand would be upon her. I pray that more sales associates would contact her in the name of Jesus to get on her team, because she is the team that represents the Most High God with the most sales, with the most people, with the best plan. I pray right now that people would come from all over the United States of America, even global, to contact you to become one of your representatives for Monet. I pray that now in Jesus' name. And as you receive it, so shall it be. As a man or a woman thinks in their heart, so is he or she. Come on, say we're winners. I want you to type that online. Say, I'm a winner. I have the victory. We don't fight for victory, friends. We fight from it. I don't have to pray that God gives me the victory. He's already paved the way for my victory. Can someone say amen? Amen. Someone say a better amen. Amen. Come on, who else has got the victory in here? I got the victory, man. My whole life, my whole house, everything that I have, it all is because of God. This building, we didn't have the money to build a building. Where's all my board members? Am I right? We didn't have the money. God opened up a door. We decided to sow some seed, and he took care of our need. We're not debt-free, but come on, with every hand raised in here, I pray right now that this church moves into a debt-free position within the next 10 years, God. Actually, 5 years, God. 5 years, we'll be debt-free in the name of Jesus. I pray right now that you bless your people so much, God, that we get debt. I pray that there would be men and women that rise up in this house that would help us pay off that debt because of their overflow, because of their increase. Now, just pull that down from heaven. If you want something to get that. You see, when you attach what you have to what God wants, you'll have a heart on fire. The gift can be neglected, though. Unattended fires go out. Let me say this. If you want to write something down, if you want to type something in the comment section, type this. Unattended fires lead to unanswered prayers. unattended fires lead to unanswered prayers. Faith is the supernatural key that unlocks the miraculous. How do I know that? I'm going to prove it to you right now. You see, there's a prayer that you could pray for people, and then there's the prayer of faith that you could pray for people. In James 5:15, says that the prayer of faith, when it's offered in faith, that's the kind of prayer that makes a man well. Amen? Sometimes people pray for other people, and it's a nice gesture. I'm going to keep you in prayer, brother. I'll keep you in prayer, sister. That's not the prayer of faith. The prayer of faith looks something like this. Father, I pray right now that anything that is hindering this body for this believer, I curse it now in Jesus' name. I pray against any internal problems. I pray against any external problems. I curse it. I send it back to hell where it belongs. I pray this in great faith. I believe right now for complete and total restoration of this body. I pray right now that not only do you heal her, but you bless her. Lord, I pray that her blessing would be tangible. I pray that people would see the blessing. I pray that people would notice the blessing. Lord, she's been gifted. We heard her sing, God. I pray that that anointing goes through another level in Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray right now that everything that she's been sowing for, everything that she's believing for, I pray it manifests now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And all of God's people said, amen. How many believe that that could happen? Yeah. Do you believe that that could happen? That's pretty good so far, right? Yeah. We know. Do not neglect that spiritual gift of faith. Too many Christians running around believing God for stuff without faith. They say it with their mouth, but they don't believe it in their hearts. They praise them with their lips, but their hearts are far from him. Amen? They're hypocrites. They're fakes. No tangibility. You know what I get slanted for all the time? A false prophet. Okay. First of all, I never claimed to be a prophet, though I have prophesied and things have come true. Can I get a witness? If I prophesied over your life and things have happened for you, say amen. Amen. I'm not saying that. I don't claim to be a prophet. I'm a pastor. I teach people. I help raise people up. I impart things to people. When God jumps on me, I just let him have his way. It makes people happy. It makes people sad. It makes people mad. Jesus said they'll hate you because of me. All right? You know, I got a long list of haters, but I got a long list of supporters that's twice as long as my haters. Can I get an amen? I got some people that know the anointing of God. I've got some people that understand that God calls a man or a woman into a city for a great work. And if you get underneath that anointing, yours will increase just as long with it. Can I say amen? Amen? Amen. Don't neglect that spiritual gift that you have, the gift of faith. Let God use you, let him use your mouth, let him use your life, and you will be a testimony. Look at this. Say, what I have is a gift. What I give is a guide. 1 Timothy 4:15 says, give your complete attention to these matters. Throw yourself into your task so that everyone will see your progress. Progress in what? Your faith. Faith progresses. How many have greater faith today than they did in the past? Let me tell you something, okay? My faith today is not the same faith I had in the past. I've had some serious manifestations. What's your greatest blessing of faith? I believe God for kids. I got four of them. Lord have mercy. I believe God for a home, he gave me a home. A car. I've been blessed with a car. I've given a car. This is a blessing. This is faith. I get attacked from people that have produced nothing. Zero. And they attack this work of God. First of all, a man or a woman of God never attacks another man or woman of God. You want to know a false teacher? You want to know a false prophet? People with big lips and little hearts. Start shooting her mouth off about the anointing of God. You know what I mean? David wouldn't even touch Saul. Touch not thy anointed. You bring a curse on your life. I feel like typing on Facebook sometimes, you know what I mean? I pray that the same weapon you're using to try to destroy somebody destroys you. I just feel like saying that sometimes. That's just me. Hey, listen, David prayed Psalm 107. Go read that. You know, wipe out their families, wipe out their children. I mean, that's bad. I'm not praying that far. That's ruthless right there. That's some ruthless prayers right there, you know. Kill them all, God. Kill their family. Take their dogs, their cats, Lord. You know, it's a little fleshy there, you know, a little bit. I don't even do that. But you know what? It's time for the Church of Jesus Christ to put an end to backbiting. It's time for the Church of Jesus Christ, time to put an end to destroying somebody else's work. You're not going to be judged on somebody else's work. You're not going to stand before, well, I told them, God, I told them that they were false prophets, you know. What did you do? What have you done? Zero, goose egg, at zilch. Next. That's my prayer, that doesn't happen to you, that you get trained up, you get raised up. Say, what I have and what I give. What you release with your mouth is what comes back to your life. Use your mouth to bless people. Use your words to help people. Not destroy people. Not talk about people. We got people sitting at home on Facebook talking bad about everything else. They don't even go to church. Shut up! You know what you need to do? You need to delete every single one of them clowns. With their low-grade Bible study that's completely false teaching. Shut up! Go out and win people for the Lord. Stop talking about other ministries and other churches. Give your attention to things that matter. People are going to hell, and you're helping everybody. You know what I give my attention to? My assignment. You know, I'm thankful that I got men and women of God around me to help me focus on that. Because I get pulled on all kinds of stuff, okay? You got to remember, I came off the streets. We handle things differently. Okay? Hey, listen, the Catholic Church kept the thing alive for a long time. They took care of people. Aren't you glad that we've got Jesus Christ today? Amen? Don't let things pull you from your purpose. The Apostle Paul was telling Pastor Timothy to manage what matters. He was talking about gossip. He was talking about, you know, things, you know, miss and, you know, avoid godless chatter, vain traditions. You know, forget about godless myths. Focus on what matters. Don't get in those heated, stupid discussions. Stay out, yeah, delete, get out of that and manage what matters. Souls matter. People matter. Your service matters. Your life matters. Your wife matters. Your family matters. Your children. Stop playing around on Facebook and start ministering to your children. Start setting a good example. That's what the Apostle Paul was telling Timothy. He says, guard your life, guard your doctrine, make sure how you live among the pagans, make sure that you stay right and true to the gift of faith. Manage your mouth. First Timothy 4:12, don't let anybody think less of you because you're young. Be an example to all believers in what you say, in the way that you live, in your love, your faith, and train yourself to be godly. Godliness takes training. Let me just, I'm gonna help you right now, I'm gonna give you money. Can you just give me 10 more minutes, okay? Okay? You have to train yourself to be godly. Okay? You don't rub a magic lamp. Genie Jesus, little mini genie Jesus, make me godly. When you get saved, you're not godly. You have God in you, but you need to train yourself to be godly. You have to train yourself to learn how to listen to that still small voice. You got to listen for those whispers of God. You've got to learn how to walk under authority. You've got to learn how to take direction before you give direction. Hallelujah. This is a supernatural body. This isn't an organization. This is an organism. The head of this church is Jesus Christ. If you can't listen to the big loud voice, how are you ever going to listen to the still small voice? You can't take direction from a man of God. What makes you think you're going to take direction from God himself? Well, I just don't agree with what he's saying. I'm preaching the word of God. That's the scripture of God. You know how many times I've ministered to somebody over the phone or in person? I just laid out scripture after scripture, and they just, well, you know, I'm just not there yet. Okay. What do you mean you're not there yet? You've been doing this thing for 22 years. When are you going to get there? How are you going to get there? How are you going to get there if you don't know how to get there? I'm here. I found you. You're right here. You don't need to go find yourself. You're right here. I just need to find myself. You're right here. You are right here. You don't got to go find yourself. You're right here. Okay? People just need to obey the word of God, not just hear the word of God. But faith comes by hearing the word of God. So as you build up your faith, it moves towards obedience. Hearing should be moved into doing. A lot of people hear, but they don't do. That's not really hearing. Manage what matters, Timothy. The Apostle Paul was also telling Pastor Timothy not to waste time on worthless matters. 1 Timothy 4:7, have nothing to do with godless mess or old wives, rather train yourself to be godly. Let me say this, your fire requires your focus. If you don't focus on your fire will go out. What is the fire? That's the faith of God. As you use the faith of God, it gets brighter. It gets stronger. We go from faith to faith. Can someone say amen? Faith needs to be built up. Romans 10:17. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of Christ. Faith needs to be seen. Faith is seen when progress has been made. Frustration is revelation without manifestation. Frustration is revelation without manifestation. God reveals something to you, but you never allow it to manifest. Why? Because of faith. That can't happen. God can't do that. All things are possible. What do you mean God can't? God, there's nothing God, the only thing God can't do is change your heart. Amen. Or get you to believe. Say what I have, what I give, what I guard. 1 Timothy 4:16, keep a close watch on how you live and your teaching. Stay true to what is right for the sake of your own salvation and for the salvation of those who hear you. I watch what I do and what I say most of the time. Sometimes things just slip out. Can someone say amen? Anybody have any slips up in here? Yeah, oops. Sometimes you just let it happen. Just that, this, God will forgive me. They just need to be told the truth. You're an idiot. No, I'm just kidding. Can't do it all the time, Letty, okay? Poquito, okay? You're working on yourself, that's right. Let God do it too. Amen. So the Apostle Paul was telling Pastor Timothy, guard your lifestyle and your doctrine. He was to guard his ways and his work. I'm a pastor. I'm a street pastor that God is using, amen. But there's some things that rise up in me sometime that just won't see, okay? Tú también? Okay. There's some things that rise up sometimes. I just want to take care of it. God, I got this one. No. Help somebody else right now. I got this one. Please let me have this one. I know what to do with this one. Anybody else just ever want to beat somebody up? Come on, Pastor Roberto. You ever want to be just, come on, we know. You'll stop. Right there, look, she's standing up for the glory. Okay. Yeah, honestly. Whoever thought, man, I just like to punch him right in the face. Whoever thought, like, you know, I just like to punch her right in the nose. It's okay to have those thoughts, right? It's not okay to act those thoughts out, though. Right? The Bible says that we take every thought, we take it captive, and we make it obedient to Christ. Come on, can someone say amen? Here we got 1 Corinthians 10:13 up in there. Come on, somebody. I don't hear nobody. That God has given us a mind that helps us. That God has given us a guide to ensure our victory. We go from victory to victory. Even our faith is a source of victory. We've been given the victory. So why do we want to focus on things that don't matter? Me making the front page news of the Boston Herald for beating somebody up at Walmart isn't going to help the church. Me making the front page of the Boston Herald because I had a massive outreach where 10,000 people came to know Jesus Christ as Lord of their life, as the spirit of forgiveness has left my body and has gone into another. After the import, after we planted 100 churches full of the Holy Ghost. Come on! That's what matters most. I make my body my slave with every person standing. Yeah, Donnie knows exactly what I'm talking about. I have an imaginary graveyard in the back of my mind where I've buried a lot of people. But they all are demons. Because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and rulers of this dark world. These are the things we battle. It's not people. As much as we think it's the people, it's not the people. That's why you have to know your word. That's why you have to operate in the spirit. So we don't do something stupid that causes people not to come to Christ. We do something smart that causes everybody to come to Christ, because if Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men. The reason this church is so successful, because God runs this church. I allow the Holy Ghost to speak to me, to teach me, to show me. Hallelujah. I fight against every demonic force in hell to get to where we are. I promise you. I fought a demon just for you. But God is blessing you. I want to say this real quick in closing. In Matthew chapter 13, Jesus is talking to his disciples and people around, and he's teaching a parable about sowing and reaping. He's talking about sowing wheat, but then the enemy came and sowed tares inside the wheat. And he gives this illustration of the farmers wanting, they came to the master, they said, you know, We got to pull the tares out of the wheat so it doesn't choke out the harvest. And the master says, let the wheat and the tares grow together. We will separate them at the harvest. Because if we pull the wheat now, I mean the tares now, it'll destroy the wheat with it. Friends, we have to let God separate the chaff, the tares, and the wheat. That's why we don't respond. Let me tell you something about the wheat and the tares. When they are first planted and they first sprout up, they look exactly the same. They look exactly the same. You can't tell the difference between a wheat and a tare. It's the enemy that comes in and sows the tares, plants the tares. Let me tell you, there's tares in every church. But as it matures, as it grows, you can begin to identify the wheat and the tare. They look exactly the same when they're growing. But when they're mature, they look completely different. The tares look like wheat, but they're all black inside. Dark. Not a color or a racial thing, but a spiritual thing. Darkness. Where the wheat is golden and bright and light. If you're around people that don't seem right, it's because they're not right. If you have the Spirit of God in you, and it makes your spirit uneasy, separate yourself, or God will do it for you. You know what I guard? You. How? I pray that God cancels every negative, every destructive, every demonic thing that tries to attack you. I intercede for you in prayer and fasting. The reason we're able to grow is because God chokes out the tares and strengthens the wheat. People come and go. You need to make up your mind who you are, what you have, who you're going to listen to, and what you're going to do. Watch your life and your doctrine closely. Make sure that you are lined up right with God. Every person needs a pastor. Guess what? I didn't get to choose those things. God chose those for me. I've honored every pastor I've ever served in. And God made me one. Because you'll never be what you speak against. And if you are, you might not be on the right team. There's two types of churches. There's his church that he builds, and there's other churches that other people build. I've made up my mind. I don't want to be a church of programs. I want to be a church of his presence. Can someone say amen? I don't want to be a natural organization. I want to be a supernatural organism. I don't want to be the highest authority in this church. I want him to be. I have a pastor that I run everything through. My pastor tells me things I don't want to hear sometimes. He says things I don't agree with. but I'm obedient and I listen to him because he's there to help me. I have supernatural people. I have a prophetic voice in my life. I have people that work together to help me to become the man of God that God's called me to be. My pastor will pull my wife aside and say things like, "How's he treating you?" My wife has a phone number to call if I ever get off base. We need that in our lives. It's called a supernatural check and balance. People that don't have pastors are in trouble. People that preach and don't get preached to are in trouble. We need to be connected. There's a kingdom, there's a king, and the kingdom puts people in place to operate in his stead. With every head bowed and every eye closed. Tares are there to destroy your faith. If it doesn't build your faith, it's destroying your faith. There's two types of people in your life, people that will build you up and people that will tear you down. There's voices you should listen to and there's voices you should not listen to. Certain choices need the right voices. Make sure you are listening to the right people and not the wrong people. If you're called to this church and this is your home church, I'm here to help you. My team is here to help you. We operate as one. We are not divided because a house divided against itself cannot stand. We are in a new season, my friend. This is a new chapter that's coming. We are leveling up in the name of Jesus. We are going to another level. What do you mean? There's levels? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm preaching and the Spirit's hitting you like a hammer. Some of you. If Dr. Rodney Howard Brown was here, it'd be like somebody dropping an anvil on you. Because there's levels in the kingdom. There's generals, there's first lieutenants, there's captains. Think about what I'm saying. We are the body of Christ. We are many members, but one spirit. And that spirit is the Holy Ghost. Father, I pray for every single person in this room. I pray that you help every single person. I don't want this service to be like a normal, everyday. This is not what we're doing. Father, we seek your face. I want to see your face. I want to be where you are in a greater way. And I want you to have me and use me for your glory. Lord, I pray that you would strengthen my faith, that you would build such a great fire with inside my heart that it causes other people to get on fire. I pray that faith would be the prevalent currency at Crossroads Community Church. I pray for manifestation after manifestation. I pray that there'd be so much supernatural activity in this house that people tell everybody about it. I pray that people would come from all over the world to come and see what God is doing here at 839 Ashby State Road. I pray for the sons and daughters of God to be revealed. I pray for pastors. I pray for evangelists. I pray for mighty men and women of God. I pray for worship leaders, God. I pray that there would be so many churches planted out of this church that people would write books about what happened in New England. I pray that the next great awakening happens right here at 839 Ashby State Road, that you make Fitchburg, Mount Zion, God's holy mountain. I pray that this would be a place where men and women would be trained for the ministry. I pray men and women would be trained for supernatural ministry. I pray for the river of God to be released from this house that would go out into every street, on every corner in New England, and New England shall be saved in the name of Jesus. Come on, if you are going to be part of that end times harvest, I need your amen to be the loudest amen in this house today. Amen! 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 Hallelujah. If you want God to use you in this end times harvest, I need you to get out of your seat and get to these altars right now. God's going to release something supernatural in here this morning. God's going to anoint his people for a great work. Come on. Come on. I'm not looking for spectators. I'm looking for participators. People that want to be used, want to see their families change for the glory of God. See the anointing come so strong. Push up. Come on. Hallelujah. Praise God. Man, you people are on fire today. Oh, glory. 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 Hallelujah. With every hand lifted in this house, right now, Lord, release a greater measure of faith into the hearts of your people. I pray for supernatural blessing. I pray for supernatural activity. Praise God. Look at this little girl. Father, use her for your glory. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Release great faith. Now, I just need you to touch heaven and just pull it down into your life. Come on. God's going to save your family. God's going to build his kingdom. You are going to be part of the end times wealth transfer, where God is going to take the wealth from the wicked and bring it into the house of God, and he's going to do it through people like you. I pray for wisdom and insight. I pray for strategies, concepts, and structures that God would give you an idea or a pattern or something that you could put towards the building of God's kingdom. I pray for your businesses. I pray God would use you. I'm telling you, if you're 8 or 80, God's not through with you yet. It's your best is yet to come. Hallelujah. You may have already done great things, but this ain't over, baby. This is the church of the living God, and his name is Jesus Christ. Clap those hands, all ye people. Now, I want you to just put your hands to heaven. I know this is craziness to some people. If you're watching online, just put your hands. Put your little emoji hands up. And just go ahead and pull it down into your heart right now and into your life. Come on. Symbolic of us trusting God and us having faith. I do this at home. I got my kids doing it. You know, this is what I've been trained. And this, my friend, works. Come on, let's clap those hands. Get ready. Get ready for explosive growth. How many are ready for this harvest that's coming? How many want to help me with the harvest? It's time for us to put on our most holy faith. It's time for us to model, to watch our doctrine and our lives closely. May we be the Bible that someone reads. May the word be so rich in us that people see the word of God. The light has come and the darkness cannot stop it. Chip and Kim, you guys, I can't tell you how much I love this couple. Kim has done so much to help us with our children's ministry for the years, for zero, for nothing. I couldn't even give her money. I let him pay. Let me do something. And you care about people so much and the children so much, you must be like astounded all the stuff that's happening. It's going to be supernatural. And as you put your hands to the Lord, I just pray that you see what you saw manifested, not just a dream anymore, but let the manifestation come now. And I pray that soul after soul after soul, that you will see and you will begin to realize, man, look what the Lord has done. And I pray that from your children to your grandchildren, I pray against every weapon that's designed to destroy your family. I know that you've been protecting them, but you wait and see what's going to be unleashed and released through your children and your children's children. A godly man has an inheritance for his children's children, and that inheritance is the kingdom of God, the blessing of the Lord. Father, I pray for a greater blessing for them in Jesus' name. I know you've been great to them, but be greater. Greater is he. Hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah. He loves you very much. I can't tell you how proud I am of you. I can't tell you how amazed I am every time I see you. How the Lord's taken us from a second floor apartment all by ourselves, trying to figure out what we're going to do next, to blessing us with a family that's remarkable. Hallelujah. Go and sin no more.